Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Port Canaveral. I'm Kevin Markey. I'm chairman of our Port Authority Board of Commissioners. And on behalf of my fellow commissioners, it's a distinct honor and pleasure to welcome you here to the 2023 State of the Port. In a few minutes, we will welcome our very capable CEO, John Murray, to the stage to provide details of the port's successful year of operations in 2023. And he'll also talk about what's on the horizon for the port as well. Before we get underway, however, please join me in Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'd like to acknowledge some of our guests in attendance this afternoon. We, of course, have the Board of Commissioners, Commissioner Lloyd, Commissioner Wayne Allender, Commissioner Fritz Van Volkenberg, and Commissioner Justice. I would also like to recognize from the office of Senator Marco Rubio and Rick Scott, and representatives from our U.S. congressional members, Congressman Posey, Soto, and Webster. And I believe the mayor of Cape Canaveral, Wes Morrison, is in attendance. And I would also like to acknowledge our partners in attendance here today, the Florida Department of Transportation, Space Florida, Orlando International Airport, Titusville Coco Airport Authority, Melbourne Orlando International Airport, the Space Coast Transportation Planning Organization, Brevard County Government, Space Coast Economic Development Commission, Canaveral Pilots Association, Army Corps of Engineers, United States Coast Guard, United States Navy, U.S. Customs and Border Protection, and finally, the United States Space Force. Welcome. I would also like to start by offering the board's sincere appreciation to Captain Murray and Mike Poole, the port CFO, and really the entire port team. I brag on them all the time. We really have an outstanding group that helps this port be successful and helps our commission job to be a little bit easier than it otherwise would be. And I'm proud to say that their hard work and commitment to the port this past year has continued to generate success for the port, which you're going to hear about in more detail. The growing number of cruise passengers that sail from our port week after week show the strength and popularity of our port, including the millions of cruise guests from over the United States and overseas. I'd like to also remind everyone about the completion of extensive renovations recently to North Cargo Berth 3 and the start of renovations on North Cargo Berth 4. Illustrates the growing volume of cargo moving through our port and underscores the significant role Port Canaveral plays in the economic diversity and prosperity of the Space Coast and of Central Florida and the state of Florida. With all business segments of the port finishing this year with financial stability and a healthy growth outlook, it's important to thank our port partners for their commitment to our port. As we all like to say, your success is our success. And finally, with the fiscal year 2023 behind us and a very promising 2024 on the horizon, my fellow port commissioners and I extend our deep appreciation to our entire port community for your continued support of our mission. And with that, let's begin our 2023 State of the Port presentation.
Hi, I'm George Kistner, the port historian. Did you know that Port Canaveral recently marked its 70th anniversary? A vision that took over 75 years to bring to life. The port you see today bears little resemblance to its humble beginnings. On November 4th, 1953, Port Canaveral was officially dedicated with the USS McClellan proudly moored at the West Marginal Wharf. The ceremony drew a crowd of 2,600 attendees and was presided over by then Senator and former Florida Governor Spressard Holland Sr. In his address, Senator Holland called Port Canaveral our nation's port for inner and outer space, linking the port's significance to the nation's emerging space program. In the early days, Port Canaveral was not much more than a hole in a muddy channel, nestled on the north side with a small warehouse and a few fishing boats. Our role back then was to be a drop point for commercial fishing and fuel distribution. It was just a few years later when the port welcomed its first commercial cargo vessel, the SS Moore Max Spruce. But the commercial trade significance of Port Canaveral was just beginning to be realized. By 1966, cargo tonnage had surged to a staggering 1 million tons per year, signifying our rapid ascent as a major gateway. Today, the port's cargo throughput has grown exponentially, with an annual discharge of nearly seven times that initial figure. Nearly three decades passed before the first cruise ship, the Scandinavian Sea, found its permanent berth at Port Canaveral. With the growing allure of Orlando's theme parks and the surging appeal of Cocoa Beach nearby, the cruise industry began to take notice of our port. As we entered our fourth decade, it was undeniable that indeed we were a growing port in a growth market. From that point forward, there was no turning back. Early on in our history, the United States military underscored the strategic significance of Port Canaveral, with naval vessels having a regular presence in this newly created seaport. It's well known that Port Canaveral's history has intertwined with the space industry. Throngs of rocket watchers flocked to our port and nearby Cocoa Beach to witness historical launches that were the promise and precursor for human space travel. In the early days of the U.S. space program, our port was the scene of colossal Apollo rocket boosters strapped onto barges transiting through the Canaveral Lock. Today, our port continues to play an important role in the 21st century space program, supporting a growing commercial space industry and welcoming a new generation of space enthusiasts eager to celebrate their success. That sleepy, muddy-watered Port Canaveral of back then has grown to be one heck of a thriving maritime powerhouse today.
700,000 travelers, 1.7 million passengers.
Port Canaveral is now the
busiest port now.
The biggest in the world.
The world's busiest cruise port.
Number one port for cruisers.
In the entire world.
And we are busy. And we're busy because we're an easy port to get to, an easy port to get through, and the best experience you'll have boarding and departing a vessel of any port in the United States. We now have some of the latest and newest tonnage in the world on our cruise fleet. That's a big driver for why people want to come to Port Canaveral, because we do have some of the best ships in the world. Port Canaveral is very much a hands-on port. Even in our cruise operations, we have a very large cruise operations team that's facilitating traffic, parking, guest directions, et cetera, to make sure that our guests have the ultimate experience getting to and from the ship. As we view our business as we're the first and the last thing that the cruise guest sees before they get on or off the ship, our goal is to make that as seamless as possible. The bigger ships come to Port Canaveral because we deliver. The ships are full. That's a big, big plus for us. If we can fill a ship every week, then that's a benefit to the cruise lines. I think our biggest innovation right now is our new parking system that we're rolling out. Cruise guests at Port Canaveral all pay on arrival, so that expedites the vessel when the vessels return from voyage. And because of the advancements in customs and border protection and facial recognition, it allows the guests to get off the ship almost immediately. So by paying on entry, it allows people to get to their car and then immediately flow out without having to stop. We've got two ships right now, the Mardi Gras and the Disney Wish, that are powered with liquefied natural gas. We were the pioneer in cruise ports in the United States for LNG fuel supply. Next year, we'll have the Utopia of the Seas coming in for Royal Caribbean. That's also a natural gas powered ship. And the Disney Treasure will come in at the end of the year, also natural gas. So we'll have four ships next year, by the end of the year, that are natural gas powered vessels. Our goal at Port Canaveral is to provide the best guest experience to our cruise line customers. And by doing that, we ensure repeat customers coming back to the port, and it ensures our growth in the cruise industry. We're very excited for the future. We have some great assets coming online in the next few years, and a lot of surprises for the business as a whole.
Out of service for 9 years, this ribbon cutting reopens Port Canaveral's North Cargo Berth 3 with nearly 900 feet of new dock space for larger ships.
Port Canaveral is expanding their cargo capabilities by rebuilding North Cargo Bay 3.
But now, after a roughly $50 million renovation, the port says it's welcoming its first deliveries to the new dock.
You know, our cargo business has grown significantly in the last few years. It's largely been driven by the construction boom in Central Florida. A lot of our materials that come through the port are aggregates that are used in highway construction and in building construction. We also have had significant fuel deliveries. We are a main supplier for Orlando International Airport, as well as three other airports in the area. It's been busy. When we shut a port down for a weather event, we have the last cargo to stop running is fuel, and the first cargo to start when the port reopens is fuel. And that's because in Florida, many places we have a mandatory evacuation, and people need fuel to get out of the state or out of wherever they're being evacuated from, and then they need fuel to get back home. Fuel for generators, fuel for all sorts of things, and that's why our fuel supply is so critical, particularly during a weather event. The other piece of business that's been very active for us is the space industry. Recovered boosters from offshore come back into Port Canaveral, and they're recovered at our cargo docks. And sometimes that's a multi-day event, and that's become a very active part of our cargo business as of late. We're bringing a second mobile harbor crane because our gantry cranes that were built back in the early 1970s are functionally obsolete, and it's time to improve. So this gives us a lot more flexibility and capabilities going forward into the future.
Industrial, space, cargo, and of course, cruise.
Warm. The port's taking a big step toward expanding, too, beyond just a spot to hop on a cruise.
The port needs more garage space.
We have two garages under construction. One will be adjacent to Cruise Terminal 6. The other one will be at Cruise Terminal 10. We also have a very, very large flat lot development at Cruise Terminal 1 in anticipation of the new larger ships that'll be coming in the next year. And we're building both garages in anticipation of new services, which will start at the end of 2024. We also have Disney Cruise Line bringing a third vessel to the port toward the end of the year. And we will also, for next winter season, have both Princess Cruise Line and Celebrity Cruise Line operating from the Northside terminals. We just completed our renovation of North Cargo Berth 3, and we are in construction with North Cargo Berth 4 right now. We expect that to be finished sometime in the third quarter of 2024. These two docks have been out of service for more than 10 years. We started with North Cargo Berth 3, and we have had our first ship there in June of 2023. The new dock will be a total length of close to 1,800 feet, which will allow us to put two vessels there at the same time. We also have a continuing need to support the space industry, and these docks will help us in that endeavor as well. Many of our tenants, port tenants on the cargo side, have had significant capital investments over the last year or so. Heidelberg Materials has just expanded their primary slag production facility, which will give it about another 50% more capacity than it had before. Seaport Canaveral just recently installed all new fuel lines above dock. So they went through a significant investment and raised everything, so they're elevated along berth 1 and 2. ASI has been purchased by a company called Instructure, which is now the largest bulk and break bulk operator in the United States. Instructure has been investing in our port and in infrastructure, and we're talking to them about additional facilities such as warehouses and other properties that they will be able to bring new business through Port Canaveral. The road infrastructure in and out is the lifeline to the port.
We have one way in, one way out on State Road 528. There are plans for that road to be expanded, and that is one of our critical roadways that needs to be improved. Also, the 401 bridge, Route 401, goes to the north side of the port. That's where all of our cargo operations, the majority of our cargo operations with Heidelberg and Seaport Canaveral, there's trucks coming over that bridge every day. There are drawbridges that are functionally obsolete. The challenge we have is that they get stuck open on occasion, and that interrupts cruise guests. This past year, we did almost 6.8 million cruise guests in 1 year. So the traffic on the road, both from the cargo side and the cruise side, has increased exponentially. And as a result, we need the infrastructure improvements outside the port in order to continue our growth. We've done a lot with some of the public safety grants that we've gotten. We have bollards, safety bollards. We're upgrading our lighting systems throughout the port, our traffic systems. We'll be doing that next year at Cruise Terminal 1. We've got a project to widen the turn lane into the terminal and add some directional signaling. We've got a new fire truck coming for Canaveral Fire and Rescue. We have a new boat coming for Brevard County Sheriff's Office for their marine safety operations. We continue to upgrade our equipment as needed for the benefit of all of our cruise guests having a safe passage to and from their ship. You know, all of our development and projects that we're doing at Port Canaveral contribute to the overall community and jobs and economic prosperity for our region and the Canaveral Port District and for the state of Florida. We're a very busy port. The more business we do, the more economic benefit there is to the state and to the community at whole.
What an incredible journey it's been. In just 70 years, we've witnessed the remarkable transformation of Port Canaveral. From our humble beginnings to our vital role as an economic powerhouse today, one thing's for certain, there's simply no port quite like Port Canaveral.
And now, introducing Port Canaveral CEO, Captain John Murray.
Yeah, you thought you'd seen enough of that guy already, and now you got me for another 2 hours, so life is good. It was a busy year, and that was a great recap of a lot of what happened last year, and it's going to be an exciting year coming up. We're going to talk about that in a minute, but first I want to show a quick graph to just show you where we've been in our 70-year history. And what's great on this graph is you look at 2003, we're 5 times more operating revenue today than we were 20 years ago, and we're 3 times what we were 10 years ago. So we've really had a very, very successful 20 years that have brought this port to where it is today. So next, I'd like to talk just a little bit about how we finished last year. Our fiscal year runs from October 1st to September 30th, and we just finished it, had our board meeting, and this meeting usually follows our board meeting after we report our year-end results. We did $158 million in cruise last year. That's a new record. $21 million in cargo, also a new record. Non-ship revenue was $12 million, but we finished the year just shy of $191 million. That is a significant jump from last year when we finished the year at 127. So we look at this as a great success, quite a year at this port. You can see this is just an example of our operating revenue and how it's split out through the year. Generally, our strongest months are December, April, March, April, and July, so each quarter has 1 month stronger than the rest. The trailing end on the right side of the chart does not mean the business is decreasing. Those numbers were higher than they were in 2022, but it's just the cyclical side of our business. And August, September are traditionally when the kids go back to school, and they're two of our slowest months on the cruise side. So how did we do it last year? Well, first off, we did 6.8 million cruise guests. That's a new record. Last year, we did 4.1 million. Our best year ever was 4.7 in 2019. So that is 2 million more guests than we did in our best year ever. We had 13 home ported ships during the winter season, 906 ship calls. And something that we've got another metric now, we had 840,000 cars come in and leave Port Canaveral only cruise guests, just cruise guest vehicles. So quite a bit of traffic on our roads. On the cargo side, 3.7 million tons in petroleum products, 1.9 million in aggregates. Lumber was strong at just under a million tons. And general cargo, which includes everything from refrigerated goods to liner board to space business, was 533,000. We, this year, conducted a new economic impact study for Port Canaveral. The last one we did was based on 2018 data, and we thought it was time, given our expansive growth, to run a new report. The new report came in. We have a statewide impact of $6.1 billion total impact. Almost 43,000 jobs are attributable to what we do here. $2.1 billion in wages, people earning that 43,000. And the other piece is almost $190 million goes to taxes, state and local tax revenues. So a lot of our municipalities make money based on what we do here in Port Canaveral. That's not revenue from us. So where are we going in 2024? We're projecting our cruise revenue at $154 million. You may ask why that's less than last year, and there's a technical reason in some of our cruise line contracts. We have a component of the terminal when we do a major refurbishment. There's a portion that is paid back by the cruise line, and one of our lines completed their payment last year, which actually had a negative impact going forward of almost $13 million. We're making that up, so we're pretty close to the cruise number we had this year, basis larger ships and more of them, and I'm going to go into that in a few minutes. We're keeping our cargo flat at $21 million. Same with non-ship revenues, so our budget for this year is $187 million. Looking at cruise, we again this winter are going to have 13 home-ported vessels, be a slightly different mix this year than we had last year. We've got forecast for 7.3 million cruise guests, which is a significant bump, but not as much as perhaps next year. This year is going to be a transitional year for us. Again, 913 ship calls, 106 provisioning calls. These are vessels located in other ports that find their way to Port Canaveral for provisioning. We have the Anthem of the Seas at Cruise Terminal 3 today, and that is one of our port of calls from New York. We also have multiple ship exchanges that I'll highlight in just a minute. Let's look at the lineup for the cruise lines. We've got Carnival Cruise Line. Carnival Freedom just came back last week. She's the one that had a missing stack, for those of you that are out at the port. She had a fire incident and had to get repaired, but they ran it without the full stack for about a year. She went to dry dock. She's back. She's got the new color scheme and a new stack. So we're glad to have her back in the rotation. Carnival Liberty is with us. She's been with us for quite a number of years now. She'll be leaving us in May next year and will be replaced by a similar ship, the Carnival Glory. That's a 3 and 4 day product from Cruise Terminal 3. The Carnival Mardi Gras will continue with us for another year. That's the LNG-powered vessel that sails every weekend. And the Carnival Vista will be joining us next week. The Carnival Vista is the Vista-class ship. It is the second largest series of ship in the Carnival fleet. We have never had a Vista-class ship sail or be home-ported here at Port Canaveral, so this is a big plus for us. The other addition on that ship is it will be a full year-round ship. The ship that's replacing the Carnival Magic was seasonal, so we'll have a year-round vessel with the Carnival Vista. Disney Cruise Lines, great partners. They'll continue this year with the Disney Wish on the 3 and 4 day and the Disney Fantasy on the weekly sailing. I mentioned earlier in the presentation that the Disney Treasure will be coming toward the end of next year. MSC Cruises, the MSC Seaside, has been with us since last winter. It will be leaving us in a couple of weeks, and the MSC Seashore will come in to replace it. The MSC Seashore has been operating in Europe through the summer, and she'll be making a transatlantic voyage for stop Port Canaveral. The ship's about 4 years newer than the Seaside, and it's a little bit larger than the Seaside, so another upgrade for MSC. Norwegian Cruise Line, the Norwegian Epic, has not been here for a few years, but it's coming back this winter. It'll be operating out of Cruise Terminal 3. It's an added starter. The ship was supposed to be elsewhere this winter season, and Norwegian decided to bring it to Port Canaveral based on the success they had with their sailings here last winter. So We have that ship. We also have the Norwegian Escape, which has been here for the last few years on the winter season. And the Norwegian Jade will be with us next spring for multiple sailings. The Royal Caribbean has got a lot of changes this year. The Adventure of the Seas is a Mariner-style ship. It'll be here in, this Friday. It'll be here this week. And it will be first time at Port Canaveral, home port, as far as I know, at least since I've been here. The Independence of the Seas, one of our favorite ships, has been here for the last couple of years since the pandemic, has left us. And that ship is now gone to another location, has been replaced by the Allure of the Seas, which came in about 10 days ago. The Allure of the Seas is the first Oasis-class ship to sail in a 3- and 4-day rotation for Royal Caribbean. It is a big ship, 6,700 passengers. The first sailing went out with about 6,200, but I think the real benchmark for me is when we parked over 1,200 cars for the first time last Friday. That's a lot of cars in one ship. Just to give you some scale, the garage behind us here is a 1,000-car garage. So we had 1,200 vehicles just for one ship. And that's going to happen every Monday and Friday now. That ship has just got that many more people. It will be replaced by the Utopia of the Seas in July of next year. The Utopia is a purpose-built ship for the 3- and 4-day rotation. The capacity on that ship is going to be near 7,000. The ship itself is a destination, really. It's going to be on the short cruises, 3 and 4 days. So when you get on that ship, you're going to probably want to stay on that ship. It'll go to Coco Cay, and there'll be some opportunities to get off there. But we're really excited. This is the first time Royal has put a brand-new ship in a 3- and 4-day rotation of this size, and they're doing it at Port Canaveral. So it says a lot about our cruise guests and the confidence they have that we can fill the ships. Mariner of the Seas has been with us for a while. She will continue. And the Wonder of the Seas will also continue for the balance of the year. Would like to point out that you hear a lot about the Icon of the Seas. It's the newest Royal Caribbean ship. It's going to Miami. It'll be the largest ship in the world. But we're going to have the Wonder, which will be number 3, and the Utopia, which will be number 2. So that's okay. They can have number 1. Cargo outlook. Just to look to the future, our cargo's steady volumes. We're looking at nothing really crazy happening this year. We think that the transportation fuels will remain steady, that the aggregates will remain steady as long as our economy is strong. And the lumber has finally come back to a normal pace. During the pandemic, some of the lumber ships were chartered into other trades, and the lumber backed up in Europe to the point that it all came at once over about a 6-month period to the port. We've kind of returned to normal lumber flows again, so that's positive. We're also anticipating an increased cadence in launch recovery operations. And I think SpaceX is driving that to the greatest degree. And I just learned right before this session here that last night was their 80th launch this year. So that's really impressive. We have challenges, though, because SpaceX is here. Almost every day you can come out here now, you can see a booster either on the dock, on the drone ship, or sometimes two, as we had earlier in the week. Optimizing our berths so that we can take care of space, take care of cargo, it's a challenge. And it's going to continue to be a challenge as the launch cadence increases and other players come into the market. Jetty Park, we got a few changes out there. During the pandemic, we were careful not to spend money on certain things. We were in a preservation mode for a better part of 18 months, and then it took a while to get back to business as usual. So now we're finally taking care of some things that needed to be taken care of. We're putting in a new camp store. We've got pavilion renovations coming on. The building that's closest to the beach is not in great shape. We looked at doing something different with that, but we've got another idea on how we can turn that into something useful. And the camp store that we're building will be accessible both from the park and the campground. Also in the campground, we've got some road paving. It's a dusty mess out there sometimes, and we've got a plan to do some paving there. And RV upgrades to the latest and greatest. The RVs have gotten bigger, as has everything else, and we need to improve our infrastructure so they can plug in and have proper hookups. We continue our discussions with Brevard Zoo on the aquarium project. It's moving slowly, but it is moving, so that's one of our projects we'll continue this year. And the last item on the list, as many of you may know, the Exploration Tower had some construction issues that we had to have repaired. It was a long process to get it done. You saw the scaffolding in the past year out there while they were doing the repairs. Those are complete. We're now trying to determine what the next steps are for the tower. It's obviously it's a great billboard for the port. Everybody recognizes it as Port Canaveral. But we had some exhibits in there that are no longer viable, and we're trying to decide the best move forward. So if anybody's looking for a really unique office space, talk to Craig Langley over here, and he'll fix you up. Near-term priorities, we have to continue investing. You know, for 2.5 years with the pandemic, we didn't invest in anything here. We had to preserve as much cash as we could just to get through. We did that. We're on the backside. First year and a half was really just rebuilding our war chest to get our projects done. So now we need to keep doing it. And I'll go through some projects here in a minute, but we need to keep rebuilding this port. Everything that we earn here, we pump back into it, and it just continues to get better and stronger. We need to maintain our operational excellence. Last year, we were the number one cruise port by a small number of cruise guests. I don't know if we'll retain the title this year. We may not. But if we aren't number one, we'll be number two. And if we are number two at 6.8 million, number one had to do even more than that. So that's good for the state of Florida. It's good for Florida seaports, Florida tourism, and the general economy in general right here in the state. So that's good news. We need to share our success with our partners. You know, we have great cruise partners that we work with, and great cargo partners, and our success can be their success. As they say, all rising tide lifts all boats, and we really believe that here. So we like to work closely with our partners so we're all successful. And we have to manage our growth with defined resources. And by defined resources, that's the biggest challenge for us. We are a very small port. Trying to get bigger is not easy for us. It might have been easy back in 1953, but over 70 years, that's one of the things that we've lost. We don't have that opportunity to just keep going into the river and grow like we did at one time. So it really does give us some challenges going forward. This is just a quick overview. We have over $500 million on our long-term capital improvements over the next 5 years, is why I say long-term. But these are some of the projects that we'll be completing or closer starting in 2024. First one on the list is North Cargo Berth 4. That's actually close to a $40 million project, but we've already invested money in our prior year, and this will be to wrap it up and finish the project in 2024. We've got port-wide parking improvements. Wow, $78 million. Well, we have two garages that are being built on the north side, as mentioned in the video, and we just finished this flat lot out here for Cruise Terminal 1. And if you are over by Victory Casino and you see all that activity over there, that's another flat lot that we're building right now to accommodate Cruise Terminal 3 when the Norwegian Epic comes. So that's going to put more vehicles in our area than we can handle in the garage. So those are the garage projects. We've got pier improvements. You know, one thing in a harsh environment like we live, the docks take a beating, and it's something we have to continually put money back into our infrastructure to keep it viable, and that's what the pier improvements are. Mobile harbor crane, passenger boarding bridges. We have a new mobile harbor crane coming. I mentioned that earlier. It is being built in Germany, be delivered. Hopefully, we'll have it on ground by January. It is very similar to the current crane that we have. In that regard, the two older gantry cranes there will be removed from the port. Either they will be scrapped or we will have an RFP going out soon to see if there's any interest in anyone purchasing them. So they'll either be purchased or scrapped, but they will be gone next year. Maintenance dredging, we have certain things that the Army Corps does, and then there's things that we have to do. And one of the things we're doing on the maintenance dredging next year is we're deepening the West Turning Basin to accommodate vessels all the way up into North Cargo Berth 8. North Cargo 8 today is only 35 feet alongside, and we want to go to 41 feet as we have at our other docks like 6, 5, 3, and 4. We're also looking to deepen the dock area over by the fuel docks 1 and 2. We see Port Canaveral brings vessels in. Sometimes there are ships on the water that could come here and deliver cargo to the port, but they just draw too much water to get in. So we're taking care of some of these areas where we can, so that we can bring bigger ships in at one time. Recreation, public facilities, I talked about some of those improvements, and then just other stuff that we do here at the port is $37 million. So we're going to spend $182 million this year. So while we made money, we're spending money. And I think that's the important part, is that we put our money back into our infrastructure. We also need to maintain our excellence, optimize use of our cruise facilities. One thing is we have 6 full cruise terminals now. And when I say full, they're all busy. Next year, we have some schedules that are going to have a couple of our cruise terminals operating at 5 and 6 days a week with the ship alongside. That's a lot of utilization. The challenge with that utilization is that doing any kind of maintenance, even as simple as cleaning the terminals after a ship departs, is difficult when you've got one coming again in 12 hours. So it really makes our life a lot more challenging to keep up the pace of what we're doing. But at the same time, we've got tremendous investments in these facilities. We need to use them and get the most we can out of them. So it's a challenge, but that's what we're here for. We also want to focus on continuous process improvements. There's always things that we can do better. One of those things, for example, is our parking systems. We had pay on exit for most of our parking garages in the port. And recently, we found that after Customs and Border Protection did some great improvements on their side, and they went to a facial recognition when you come off the cruise ship, it allowed the passengers to flow straight through and out to their cars. Well, we had one sailing, and it was on one of our lines of Cruise Terminal 10, that the ship came in. It was a 2-day sailing because they were positioning the vessel in, and everybody on the ship had carry-on luggage. So they all went through facial recognition, carry-on luggage, straight to the garage, got in their car. And if you got 4 lanes and it takes about 60 seconds to get a car through the lane, and you've got 800 cars coming down, how long are you in the garage? Hours. So we said, we can't do this anymore. We've got to change the process. CBP has made it so seamless that we need to do everything on entry. So we ended up with some handheld units. We purchased 32 of them last year, and we were able to get cruise guests coming in, and they paid on arrival. That meant as soon as the ship came in, they cleared CBP straight to the garage and out. That's had another benefit for us in that it's really mitigated our cruise traffic in the port. When people can get in, off the ship, in their cars, and out of here before the incoming guests arrive, it makes a big difference on the roadways. So despite the numbers that you've seen up there, you have not had the same number of traffic backups that we've had historically on big cruise days. It's really been an improvement, and a lot of that is due to the technology. So going back, we have to continuously find new ways to improve, and that's just a couple of examples. We need to manage our growth. Our cargo and space partners are all expanding their operations. This is the photo of the north side of the port. As you can see, we don't have but so much area there to develop. A lot of our area is already consumed. Next year, we'll have a few changes on the north side. The CMEX tower that has been there for 50 years, I guess, is going to be demolished at some point, probably later in the year, due to some other considerations with the proximity to North Cargo Berth 4 construction. But that will be coming down to free up about 4 acres on the north side. But as you can see, we are running out of space. One thing I do want to talk about for a second, though, is on this picture, you'll see in the middle of, on the top left, is a pond, a retention stormwater pond. And one of the things, talking again about continuous improvement and new technologies, that we have been working on is a smart pond technology. And it's really a unique way to manage stormwater. And what it essentially is you have a storm pond, it has a NOAA weather station on it. And when certain weather conditions, hurricane or a microburst or whatever is predicted, it'll drain the stormwater out of the pond to allow more water. What that does is it allows us to not have as many stormwater ponds. And as precious as land is to Port Canaveral, the fewer ponds that we have, the better. So we have a project right now on the south side of the port that's going to allow us to fill that in and recover. I think it's about 9 acres of land that we'll be able to recover and actually use for our regular cargo customers instead of storing water. Also here, I mentioned North Cargo 4. That will be finished sometime toward the latter part of next year. I mentioned the cranes already. And did I change slides? Here we go. Okay. I also want to talk about two items here that are very important to the port going forward. The first one, we're going to call it Cruise Terminal 4. Cruise Terminal 4 is what we've identified in our board meetings and all. We need another cruise terminal. If we had it right now, we could fill it up. We have significant demand from the cruise lines. They have ships, new ships coming. There's only a handful of ports that can handle these large ships. If you look at ships like the Oasis class, you've got New York, us, Everglades, Miami, Galveston. Those ships are very tall. They're about 235 feet high, higher than most bridges and power lines, and most seaports have that type of an obstruction. We don't, which makes it very desirable. That said, we don't have but six cruise terminals. We need a seventh, and we need it as soon as we can get it, but in all likelihood, it's going to be a complicated task to get there. Where we've envisioned the plant or the terminal would be on the south side of the port, over in the Marina District area, where Blue Points is, and it's a tough project because there are so many of our port partners and tenants and recreational people and fishermen, and everybody's involved, and our goal is to get through this. And you know, I know not everyone will be happy, but we want to try and keep as many people happy as possible. And it's going to be a major project, and there's a lot of complexities. So it's going to take us a few years to get where we need to go. What we'd like to do is redevelop the Marina District, try to tighten things up a little bit, make it more efficient. We need to improve land use. We're in a land-limited port. We also want to elevate public appearance. You know, it's the first thing anyone sees when they're coming down 528 to Port Canaveral, and we think it's important to elevate that profile. We are dedicated to supporting commercial fishing, both the wholesalers and the folks that make a living on charters and those type of operations. I mean, that's something that's part of our port, it's part of our very fabric, and we need to do what we can to protect those interests. So that is definitely part of our process. We also want to consider, as we do this project, that's a very, very busy part of the port. We have a lot of traffic, a lot of businesses, and just to come in and start building a cruise terminal, it's going to be challenging with construction. We're going to have to reconfigure roads. There's a lot of things that we're going to have to think through. And I really wanted to bring it up today because get the conversation going, because this is something we're going to be working on a lot more diligently over the next year. The other big topic that I wanted to mention was the space industry growth. We are committed to the space industry. We've always grown up with them side by side since the 1950s. We do support the launch recovery operations. Right now it's for SpaceX. We have other parties that are getting ready to do the same. Blue Origin just brought a big massive crane in a couple weeks ago. You can see that over in North Cargo 6. That's not a port crane, that's a Blue Origin's crane. We also had our charter review this year, and our charter now includes language to support commercial space, and that's gone through our board, the legislative review at the local level, and will be off in Tallahassee for final approval over the next several months. We have been very much involved in what's going to be on my next slide, but with a study that Space Florida has been conducting. We stay pretty close with Space Florida and meet with them on a regular basis just to make sure we're all on the same page on some of the operations. But there could be as many as 10 more launch service providers with maritime assets. And if you talk to them, and some of their information has been assimilated already by Space Florida, this port can't handle everything. We alone cannot accommodate the projected maritime demand. It's just that simple. So we're looking at ways that we can move to the future, which brings me to my next slide, which is the Space Florida Wharf Study. This has been sponsored by the Florida Department of Transportation. Space Florida has a contractor who's been working on this for about 7 or 8 months now. It's involving anybody that's involved in space right now, from KSC, NASA, Space Force, the Army, Navy, Port Canaveral, launch service providers, and even other entities that have an interest, contractors, whatever, in how we move forward with this. We're trying to identify maritime options beyond Port Canaveral. If we can't handle it, where's everybody going to go? So there are some options. It might involve, or probably will involve, multiple federal agencies and federal landowners, federal tenants of other federal agencies, and it could be quite complex. But the final recommendations from the WRF study are due by the year end, and I don't want to get in front of that, but I wanted everybody to be aware that we've been an active participant in this study, and I think that hopefully there'll be some positive way forward with what comes out of it. Long term, we want to preserve the value of our partner commitments that they've made to Port Canaveral. We've got some great, as I say, some great maritime assets here from the cruise lines. We've got bigger cargo ships, we've got more cargo, and we have a lot of people that are betting their businesses on our success, and we need to continue to support them. We also need to continue supporting the state of Florida's priorities. And what would that be? Fuel oil. You know, in a hurricane or any type of an event, we just had a big rainstorm in South Florida this past summer, and it flooded out their fuel facilities. We were running fuel from Port Canaveral down there on the ask of the state. So it's the kind of thing that fuel is a priority. Construction materials, all the roads and all that are built around here, a lot of that product comes through Port Canaveral. So we need to continue to sustaining our commitment to the state. We also need to bolster our competitive position to attract and maintain business in a global economy. An example of staying on top of things is during the pandemic, there were all sorts of congestions at West Coast ports, and containers were getting stuck, and refrigerated cargo in containers was spoiling. And some of the operators started changing their mind and say, well, let's go back to doing it the old way. We'll move them in pallets, we'll move frozen goods in pallets on refrigerated ships instead of in containers. Well, guess who's there to do that? Us. We do it, so we're doing that again. So it's a business that went away, but just staying on top and focused, we can get that business back. So who are we? We can sum ourselves up in three bullets. We're an economic powerhouse. Started the presentation out with that. We're also a diverse port with cargo, crews, real estate, commercial space operations. We also have recreational facilities, restaurants, boat ramps, marinas, and commercial fishing. We are all these things. That is what Port Canaveral is. So I would like to move on to the last slide. Before I do that, though, I just want to say thank you to my board. I've got, I think, the best board of any Florida CEO in a seaport. We do a lot together, and we've always been very supportive of anything we want to do here at the port, and we're all in it together, and we're making it better. And the other people I really want to thank, of course, all of our port partners, I want to thank the 250-odd people that work for Port Canaveral. I couldn't do what I do without their support every single day. And I'm the guy that stands up here and talks, but they're the ones that make it happen. And I just want to say thank you to all of you for what you do here to make this port successful. So with that, I think we have another video.
We are the supply chain.
We are going on a cruise.
We are local seafood suppliers.
We are the fun.
We are the front line. We are the backbone.
We are Port Canaveral.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out today. Really appreciate your time. Your time is valuable, and we appreciate you spending it with us for the past hour. So drive safely, and we'll see you around the port.